investigators worked through the night, a girl goes missing.
It's a surreal moment. We're feeling like this isn't happening.
And rescue teams don't have a lead.
The other alternatives to her being found start to become more of a reality.
Our week of prayer continues on today's 700 Club.
God, please intervene. This is beyond our control.
Welcome to the 700 Club. Will this weather never end? First came tornadoes and thunderstorms with huge amounts of rain. And now the worst flooding in decades has swamped part of the Gulf Coast in Florida and Alabama, and even as far away as Maryland.
So far, the violent storm system has killed at least 37 people in 8 states. Caitlin Burke has the story.
Flood warnings remain in effect all along the East Coast Thursday. Days of relentless rain, too much for creeks and streams to handle. The flood water has engulfed cars, homes, and in Baltimore, it even caused this road to collapse, sending cars tumbling over the edge.
The sidewalk's gone, the cars are gone, and everything just fell. It was like somebody came by and just ripped off the side of the road.
Pensacola, Florida, saw nearly 2 feet of rain in only 24 hours. That equals about 9 billion gallons of water, the most the Florida Panhandle has seen in a generation.
Hundreds of residents were forced to leave their homes, canoeing to reach higher ground. Other motorists were trapped in their cars for hours waiting for help to arrive. Operation Blessing arrived in Pensacola late last night. Today, teams going out into the community to offer aid to flood victims. This is that same massive storm system that unleashed at least 65 tornadoes across much of the South. Operation Blessing is also in Tupelo, Mississippi, where many of the residents lost everything.
Basically, everything looks kind of like I would imagine a war zone would look. Operation Blessing has been a true blessing. It's living up to its name.
Parts of Florida, Alabama, and North Carolina are still at risk for tornadoes. But meteorologists say that by tonight, that massive storm system will head out to sea. Caitlin Burke, CBN News.
It's horrible what's happening. It's just unbelievable how much rain has fallen down the Gulf Coast. Operation Blessing, by the way, has dispatched 3 major tractor trailer loads of food with thousands of pounds of food and supplies and water and other things that those people will need. But all of us need to get together to help people in these disasters. I ask our producers, well, what is causing this? Well, it's a front with a bunch of rain. Well, I understand there are about twice as much rain that fell like in one day in the Gulf as fell in California in the whole season.
Unbelievable.
It really is. But they sure don't have a problem with drought. I mean, it's feast or famine.
That's right. But people can participate in what Operation Blessing is doing by giving and helping us be there. And
well, we'll be on the scene wherever possible. That's what we're there for. Well, in other news, what really happened in Benghazi? Did the White House try to cover up the truth? Republicans think they have evidence to prove that was the case. John Jessup has that story from Washington. Here's John.
That's right, Pat. Republicans say they found the smoking gun that proves the Obama administration tried to hide the truth about that terrorist attack in Benghazi. 3 days after it happened, White House aide Ben Rhodes sent an email saying the top goal should be to, quote, underscore these protests are rooted in an internet video and not a broader failure of policy. Former UN Ambassador Susan Rice then repeated that talking point on several talk shows, saying the attack was the result of a protest that got out of control and not a planned assault. Security officials have testified the administration missed or ignored warning signals of the attack. Republicans say the White House was trying to protect the president from any political damage during his reelection campaign. Pat, you got to expect that there's going to be more hearings on Capitol Hill.
Well, you get sick of hearing about it, and, you know, Hillary Clinton says, well, so what? Well, people were killed, but the big thing is we've got a president. We were horrified about Nixon and the White House and the burglars and the break-in and all that stuff that went on during the scandals of the Nixon administration. But we've got a president that's every bit as bad. As a matter of fact, worse, it looks like. I mean, this is a deliberate attempt. And to take the UN ambassador and stick her out on public television to repeat over and over again the party line, which was based on a series of falsehoods. That is appalling. John.
Pat, scores of girls and young women kidnapped by an Islamic terrorist group in Nigeria are being forced to marry the men who took them. Their parents say the girls are being sold by members of the Boko Haram terrorist network for as little as $12. And as you can imagine, outrage is growing over the Nigerian government's failure to rescue the more than 200 girls kidnapped 2 weeks ago. Hundreds of people braved heavy rain as they marched to the National Assembly to demand the government do more to find and bring the girls to freedom. One community leader says Boko Haram is demanding a ransom for their release. Deadly superbugs that are stronger than the most powerful drugs are spreading around the globe. And the World Health Organization warns the problem's only going to get worse. The bugs have developed from bacteria which built up resistance to antibiotics, making drugs virtually ineffective. And that means in the future, even more common, even common infections or minor injuries could lead to death. Pat, this is a serious problem that's not getting enough attention.
It's a major story today, and I think people need to recognize. They say if a little kid is riding his bicycle and he scuffs his knee, he falls off the bike, he can die. That's what they're talking about. They can. I mean, it's that serious. Just a slight little infection now, because these superbugs have morphed against the existing antibiotics. But what they're saying is that the drug companies over the last 30, 40 years haven't really come up with any new substitutes to penicillin and the other drugs that have worked so effectively. But they have been overprescribed. That's been the problem. They have been overprescribed. And as that happens, the bugs inside of a person build up immunity, and then they begin to transform themselves into superbugs. And they say it's much more serious than AIDS. John.
Pat, a philanthropist named Joan Kroc dreamed that one day people, both rich and poor, would come together to enjoy the finer things in life. She partnered with the Salvation Army to make that dream a reality, and as Charlene Aaron reports, communities across America are now reaping the benefits.
This is the latest example of Joan Kroc's vision for bringing people and communities together. A 92,000 square foot community center located in one of the poorest neighborhoods of Norfolk, Virginia. In 1998, Mrs. Kroc, widow of McDonald's founder Ray Kroc, donated $90 million to the Salvation Army to build a community center in San Diego, California. She wanted to create a place where children and families from different backgrounds could enjoy experiences that otherwise they might not be able to afford. 3 years later, she died, leaving more than $1.5 billion to the Salvation Army to continue that work for 28 additional centers across the country. This year, the Hampton Roads Salvation Army Ray and Joan Kroc Core Community Center becomes one of the final three centers completing the historic effort. Local support for the project has been overwhelming.
So many businesses and individuals have come together to contribute and to give their support to the center, and it's just been really wonderful to see.
The new Kroc Center is designed to be the heartbeat of the community, complete with an indoor water park and a state-of-the-art performing arts center.
CBN News got a firsthand look at the center, which boasts the largest fitness floor in Hampton Roads. And the indoor-themed pool area includes a two-story, 150-foot water slide, lap lanes, and a lazy river. Salvation Army Captain Brett Meredith is thrilled to have the Kroc Center in his city.
For Norfolk to receive this is a very exciting thing and a very exciting time for the Salvation Army, but also for the community because of the transformational nature of these centers.
It's estimated the center will also bring up to 200 jobs to the area.
I'm really excited about what it's doing for the community. You know, I live right down the street. Norfolk's really stepping their game up, and it makes me proud to be a citizen of Norfolk.
It was close to where I live at, and also it had everything that I wanted to do. Go in the pool, yeah, exercise classes, all the exercise machines.
Scholarships are also available for people who can't afford the center's membership fees.
Joan Kroc's vision for these centers was that it would serve all socioeconomic backgrounds, so that when you walked in on level ground, and that when folks were served, it would be side by side, and that, you know, whether you have $1 million in the bank or $100 in the bank, you receive the help and assistance that you need.
Meanwhile, Captain Meredith says this will enable the Salvation Army to make an even greater impact on those it serves, while maintaining its spiritual emphasis.
I think that there are great needs in terms of education and cultural experiences, and we're going to work at providing those on an, you know, every day. Many of the families will probably have never been able to walk into a facility this nice and enjoy the amenities and enjoy the educational programs and things that we're going to offer. And, you know, the powerful thing is that it all happens in Jesus' name. And that's what's important.
Charlene Aaron, CBN News.
Pat, what an amazing gift.
Oh, it really was. I mean, it was $1.5 billion, and it's built on hamburgers, let's face it. I mean, that was the McDonald's hamburger, you know, billions and billions and billions of hamburgers.
Yeah.
So that's where Ray Kroc got his money, and he left it to his wife. His wife, in turn, left a good portion of it to the Salvation
Doing
Army.
Doing something good with it. That's
and,
wonderful,
it's a beautiful
it?
Center. Mm-hmm. We have a gentleman here who's just passed on. His name is Josh Darden, who was the spark plug and spearhead of the local initiative, because Joan Kroc said, you've got to have some matching money. So I think they raised something close to $30 million.
Wow.
And he also wanted not only to have the local participation in building the center, but they wanted a certain amount for endowment. So it's mm-hmm. it's very carefully thought out, and we commend the Army. The Salvation Army is a great organization.
They are an amazing
organization.
Great history.
Amen. Mm-hmm. All right.
Well, up next, into the epicenter, the center of Egypt's worst violence against Christians in 700 years.
I asked one of the kidnappers, why do you just kidnap Christians? And he said, Christians are weak. They don't retaliate with violence, and they have money.
Some of the survivors share their stories. That's next.
Pat Boone here with some good news you can trust. Today, our faith, families, and our freedoms are under attack. Polls say 2 out of 3 Americans no longer trust government. A stalled economy, weakening dollar, and politicians willing to steal money from our children to waste on unfixable problems. So, whom can you trust? Well, our money still says in God we trust. But do we? Or have we quietly allowed the things we hold sacred to be stolen by the enemies of traditional values? Today, our government spends almost twice its income, running up a tab for future generations into the hundreds of trillions. How can you stop this from happening to your family? Well, it's all covered in a fantastic new book, The Great Withdrawal, by Craig Smith and Dr. Lowell Ponte. Every American needs to read this book. Why don't you call now for a free copy of The Great Withdrawal? It's the simple truth you can trust.
Friday. Big Brother is going to school and watching what your children type.
They can track our children all the way down to the keystroke level.
Hear how privacy experts are fighting back. And then, lost in the canyons.
We could not find the road.
With no water or cell phone signal, our week of prayer continues.
It's going to be okay. Grab here, grab there.
Friday on the 700 Club.
Well, you're watching the 700 Club. Delighted to have you with us. Sentenced to death. That was the verdict in Egypt this week against several hundred members of the Muslim Brotherhood for their violent actions after the Brotherhood was thrown out of office last year. Radical Muslims have also taken their anger out on Coptic Christians. George Thomas takes us to this center of brutality where Christians are dying for their faith. We want to warn you that some of the images of this story are graphic.
August 20th, 2013.
We were at work when we heard Muslims were burning churches.
In the small village of Delga, 4 hours south of Cairo.
Leaders in the mosques were telling Muslims to attack Christians and kill them.
Allah Boutros and his father, Eskander Tos, both Christians, were in their family barbershop when a mob of Muslims attacked them.
They broke into the shop, took everything, and burned the place down.
Boutros managed to escape. His father wasn't so fortunate.
They caught my father and shot him multiple times. Then they dragged his body to the mosque.
Warning, the following images are graphic. That afternoon, someone with a cell phone recorded this video of Boutros' father's body, riddled with bullets, being dragged through the streets.
When they reached the mosque, they tied his body to a tractor and dragged him through the village again.
The mob continued to mutilate his father's body, all the while chanting Allahu Akbar, Arabic for God is great. He was buried hours later in a nearby cemetery.
The next day, some people dug up his body and dragged it through the village again. They did this three times that day.
Boutros and his family have since escaped from Delga.
We have no money, no clothes, no job. Our home is destroyed. Our business is destroyed.
Delga is part of the Minya province, center of the worst violence against Christians in seven centuries.
300 homes, 100 businesses, 15 churches, and about 10 Christian organizations were destroyed in my province.
Anba Makarias is head bishop of Minya's Coptic Church, home to the largest number of Christians in Egypt. Makarias says the killing and arson attacks happened because Christians supported the removal of former Islamist President Mohamed Morsi and his Muslim Brotherhood government.
But the cost to Egypt's Coptic community has been staggering. More than 100 churches, hundreds of homes and businesses destroyed. And today the government says it will try to rebuild all the places of worship. But the big question, what about those who have lost everything, their livelihood and their homes?
Christians in Egypt are expecting death at any time.
And he should know. Days before this interview, Makarias was the target of an assassination attempt. Driving through a town in Minya province, gunmen began firing at his car.
I thank the Lord I'm still alive, but I'm like anybody else in Minya. We all face dangers. My life is not more precious than any other soul in Minya.
Christians make up about 10% of Egypt's 80 million population. They face daily harassment nearly a year after Morsi's ouster and the government's crackdown on the Muslim Brotherhood.
They put a gun to my head and in my mouth. I started to pray, Lord, my life is in your hands, and I'm ready to go when my time is up.
We've concealed Joseph's identity for security reasons. He was abducted late last year by seven gunmen and tortured for 2 days.
I call them the 48 hours of death. No food, no water, no light, no sleeping. I was blindfolded that entire time, and they kept beating me, punching me in the face, on my shoulder and on my back.
Kidnappers routinely target Christians.
I asked one of the kidnappers, why do you just kidnap Christians? And he said, Christians are weak. They don't retaliate with violence, and they have money.
The men initially demanded a ransom of $80,000. After hours of negotiations, they settled on $43,000. Still a huge sum that Joseph says his family could not afford to pay. That's when friends from his church stepped in.
I had some money in savings, but the rest of the ransom money came from church members. I cannot thank them enough for saving my life.
Makarias says the security conditions have led several hundred Christian families to consider leaving Minya, but he encourages them to stay.
We are telling the church that they must endure the persecution. We must consider it an honor to endure this persecution, otherwise it will contradict the level of our commitment to our faith.
Egypt holds presidential elections later this month. Joseph is praying the country's Christians will see better days.
The Muslim Brotherhood's time in office almost destroyed our country, but we are thankful they never had the opportunity to finish their term. Now it will take some time to secure our country.
Meanwhile, Boutros and his family are still hiding in an undisclosed location, but hope to one day go back home to Dalga.
Christians view the current situation as an opportunity to witness about Christ through our suffering. We have to be tolerant and keep praying for our enemies.
George Thomas, CBN News, reporting from Minya Province, Egypt.
Great. Ladies and gentlemen, that's a story you're not going to see anyplace else. We're showing you the truth. This is the way it is. I don't care about political correctness in America or all the nonsense that's coming up. I read today that there's some high school students in Colorado that are now saying one nation under Allah. I mean, do they understand what they're asking for? Do they understand what Sharia means? Do they understand the subjugation of women? Do they understand the terrible jihad and the awful killings that go on in the name of Allah? Well, we want to tell you something. You need to be informed. You need to know what's going on. And there's a booklet that's produced, or at least is written by The Truth. It's a short book, but it's called Islam, Religion of Peace or War. It tells you the facts. It tells you the history. It has quotes from the Quran and from the Hadith. It tells you verbatim, 1, 2, 3, what these people really believe. Don't be seduced by political correctness. They're lying to you. This is the truth, Islam. Religion of Peace or War. We'll give it to you free. There are extra copies for churches. May cost a little bit. It costs about, I don't know, 18 cents, 20 cents a copy if you want to get a whole bunch of them. But it's free for those of you who just want an individual copy. Mm-hmm. Have you read it?
Wonderful. Yeah, I have read it. It's very enlightening. Yes, yes.
Stuff you don't realize. What's there?
Well, if you haven't spent time looking into the history behind all of it, you wouldn't know. And that somebody's done the homework for you there.
Well,
so
I went to college. We studied, as part of history, you know, jihad. And everybody understood jihad meant that these Muslims were running across North Africa killing people. It meant violent struggle. And that's what jihad was. Yeah. Now they said, oh, no, jihad means a struggle against the inner soul. That's baloney. It has to do with fighting and killing people. And that's the way it was. And when I was in college, that's what we got taught. But today, they wouldn't dare mention that in college for fear they might get fired.
Well, a lot of what's happened in our country is due to this bent toward political correctness, and that's certainly a part of that.
Well, if this is the enemy, and they are intent on destroying the democratic processes we have in America, you will be enslaved. You will either take demi status and be a second-class citizen in your own country, or you will be killed. That's what this little book tells you. That's what the Quran says. You come to an unbeliever, quote, an infidel, and you say either you convert and give alms, and then you become a demi, or you're going to get slaughtered and your head's going to get chopped off. That's what they did. It's true. Get the book. Read it. Whew! Enough.
Free.
Great.
Well, coming up, we're going to show you the miracle that brought a lost little girl home. But before we get to that, we've got your email questions. Kathy says, can you explain the Illuminati? We'll answer that, plus show you a brand new project from Operation Blessing. It's all next.
Some of the rewards of being a parent in an online school is you are right there when the student makes a discovery, when they have that aha moment.
Want to be more involved in your child's education? With online school programs powered by K-12, you can. Call or click now for your free information kit. K-12 has an award-winning curriculum supported by state-certified teachers designed to help parents be an active participant.
I'm like the conductor of the train. I get things organized and set, and then the kids take over from there.
K-12 is a public school option, so it's tuition-free. All materials are included, and it's individualized to fit your child's unique abilities and goals.
It's a commitment, and it's something that, you know, you have to embrace if you think that that's the best learning environment for them.
94% of K-12 parents say their student has benefited academically. Call or visit k12.com today for your free information kit.
Parents are advocates for their students. They want to do what's best.
You just need to be a mom that loves their child.
Here, we're committed to a heritage of rigorous scholarship, dating back over 1,000 years.
And to a faith tradition dating back 1,000 more.
This is how we create a culture of inquiry, where no topic is off limits.
and a culture of hope.
Anything's possible!
It's the freedom to think for ourselves.
And a responsibility to act on behalf of others.
It's Christian leadership.
Yes, it's San Luis, sí.
Cambiando el mundo.
And it's changing the world for the better.
It's higher learning.
It's greater knowing.
It's what makes us whole.
It's what makes us Regent.
You can find your career path, Regent University. It is so exciting. They have 20,000 graduates in about 84 different countries.
Wow.
And it's got one of the top law faculties, top 10 law faculties in the nation, according to the Princeton Review. Regent alumni include, let's see, 31 judges, legislators, military officers, and hundreds of leaders in various communities, including, we've got 4 university presidents who are graduates of the school. It just goes on and on. We've got so many different programs, and you can participate if you want to go online and get programs, but there's the number. You really ought to look into this. It's a top quality education, and you can be part of it.
Big weekend this weekend.
We got the biggest graduating class at Regent. It's 1,400 and about 38 people graduating, biggest in our history.
That's fabulous.
And in all these different disciplines, it's just amazing. About 58 different degree things. We have all kinds of doctoral degrees, master's degrees. So it'll be quite a colorful thing with all the regalia, and it'll be a beautiful day.
We'll bring it to you all Monday, I'm sure. We'll
all right.
Show you what went on. Time for some email.
Let's
are you ready?
For it.
Okay, let's bring it on. This first one is from Kathy, who says, can you explain the Illuminati? Wow, that's...
Well, you know, you've heard all this spooky stuff about the Illuminati. This was a group that was active about the time of the American Revolution, and certainly in the French Revolution. They probably were behind the French Revolution. And they had picked up some Egyptian mysticism, and they said, basically, we are the illuminated ones. We're the ones whose minds have been opened. And they were opposed to private property. They were opposed to marriage. They were opposed to the church. And they were opposed to the government that then existed. And the Illuminati included, the Freemasons had a branch called Illuminated Freemasonry, and it included some of the heads of state and nobility in countries like France. So it was a big deal at the time. George Washington was concerned about it, and others. But I don't think they really have any activity today. But it sounds evil and so forth.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's a lot of people wonder if they're still around today. Okay, this is a viewer who says, I know Jesus has died for all my sins. Will he also forgive me for future sins?
Jesus Christ, the same today for, you know, yesterday and forever. His blood covers everything that's been done, past, present, and future. But that doesn't mean that he took care of me, that I'm going to go sin some more. I mean, don't play games with him. Walk with him day to day. If we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus Christ continuously cleanses us from sin. That's what it says in 1 John. If we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ continuously. So as we're walking with him, we're continuously being cleansed. Mm-hmm. Okay.
This is Mr. Robinson, who says, I've learned that some people don't enter heaven immediately after they die, but go into purgatory. I have sins in my past, and I've learned that purgatory is a place where souls are purified in order to enter heaven. Please help me understand this place. Can people avoid this place, or is it just God's will for some?
It's not God's will for any, because it's not in the Bible. Now, that is a doctrine that has been promulgated by our good friends in the Catholic Church. We disagree with that. The Apostle Paul said this. You read it very carefully. He said, I am in a strait betwixt two. Get that, two. All right, two, not three, two. Whether to depart and be with the Lord, which is far better, or to remain in the flesh, which is needful for you. Paul never said anything about intermediate state. When Jesus was talking to the thief on the cross, he said, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus said, you will be this day, you'll be with me in paradise. Not after you've gone to purgatory. There, the idea of the intermediate state for cleansing people after they die, not biblical, all right?
Okay, this is Christine who says, whenever I post something on social media about my faith, many atheists comment that what I believe is wrong and try to argue about God's existence. Should I argue back and try to prove his existence, or should I just ignore it?
What do they say about a lion? You don't have to defend him, just turn him loose. You don't have to do that. And, you know, the Bible also says, don't cast your pearls before swine because they will turn and rend you. A swine is hungry for nuts. He wants chestnuts or whatever nuts he eats, and he roots in the ground, and you throw a precious pearl in front of him, and he thinks, that is another nut, I want to eat it. And he starts to eat it, and the thing doesn't taste good. Then he gets mad, and he turns around and takes his tusk and wants to gore you. Don't cast your pearls before swine. You talk about the social media. You've got everybody known to man out there involved. Why would you put your pearls out, and why would you argue with those people? I mean, keep your stuff to yourself, and when you got people whose hearts are open, then share with them. All right?
That's all the time we have for today. Good answers. Thank you.
Well, recently, Operation Blessing visited a farming communion that had a big problem. There were no farms because of a volcanic eruption. But thanks to some extraordinary ingenuity, this village in Guatemala was saved, and the people in that Guatemalan community have hope for the future. Watch this.
Hello, I'm Bill Horan, president of Operation Blessing International. I'm just back from a trip in Guatemala and really excited about a new agricultural program that we have down there. About 2 years ago, there was a volcanic explosion. Black ash blew up in the air and fell down all around the area, and it smothered all of the existing crops in this one particular community that we began to work in. We've trained the folks here and taught them how to make these raised beds using locally obtainable materials. They didn't have to go buy, this is rough sawn lumber, they milled locally. They use bamboo, we furnish some plastic, they line the beds with plastic, and they go to another part of the mountain, find good soil, bring it back here, put it in these raised beds, and then they use a biological organic fertilizer and very minimal amount of it, and they don't need as much water as you would to water a field or anything like that, and it's just a great way to produce a lot of produce in a small area. Ultimately, a growing bed was built for every family in the community, and it's completely transformed this village. The vegetables grow like crazy. They grow beautiful organic vegetables that are not only great for the villagers to eat, but they can also take certain vegetables to market and sell them for cash. There's certainly a need for cash that goes unmet in most communities in developing countries. So this model not only provides food, but it provides a source of income for villagers that otherwise are struggling. So we built a beautiful facility on several acres that we leased near Antigua, Guatemala. At the training center in Antigua, we were able to build a model that takes in a number of other strategies that are very useful that help make this whole thing work. For one thing, we built a structure out of local materials. We used bamboo posts for the vertical columns, lots of bamboo for the rafters, and then we purchased plastic to make the roof. We don't want rainfall. It may sound odd that we don't want the rain to fall on our growing beds, but we want to control that moisture in a very precise manner through drip irrigation. But our agronomist likes a certain type of drip irrigation that he learned in Israel. We're also using a plastic container strategy that was developed in Spain for vertical growing scenarios and ways that we can grow even more vegetables in a confined area. The raised beds usually produce somewhere between 6 and 7 times as many vegetables on a given space as in a farmer's field. This is a fantastic strategy, truly sustainable. People talk about sustainable all the time. This one really is. Once we help people get set up and train them, they can do this forever. We couldn't be more excited about this new innovative agricultural model.
Bill Horan is fantastic. He's got these fish farms down in Haiti where he's growing thousands of pounds of protein, of tilapia, frankly, get little fingerlings and they grow them. And here's is agriculture. People have a need, and instead of some grandiose program, government-sponsored, these are the people with bamboo and rough sawn logs and some dirt they haul in and...
teaching them to be self-sufficient.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. Well, I mean, it's Operation Blessing, folks. So if you want to get more information, I think it'd be Operation Blessing. You can log on to OB.com, or there's a number on your screen you can call in. But this is just one of the things that Operation Blessing is doing to alleviate suffering in this world. And this one really grabs your attention, because we can feed millions of people. Actually, they can feed themselves. We can't feed them. They can feed themselves.
Absolutely. Okay. Wonderful program. Well, coming up, an 11-year-old girl wanders off and doesn't return home.
About 20 minutes, 30 minutes, I stepped outside the door waiting for her to circle around and tell her to come in. And when she didn't do that, that's when I got in the car to go look for her.
See how she was supernaturally rescued when we come back.
Still ahead, Church on the Way pastor Jack Hayford joins us live on today's 700 Club.
Hello, friends. Wink Martindale here for 1-800-MEDIGAP, America's trusted source for Medicare supplemental insurance. You know, it's fun to take chances if you're on a game show. But in the real world, if you're turning 65 or already have Medicare Part A and Part B, call 1-800-MEDIGAP. My friends at 1-800-MEDIGAP can help protect you and save you money on Medicare supplemental insurance. Don't take a chance. Tell them Wink sent you when you call 1-800-MEDIGAP today.
Welcome back to Washington for this CBN News Break. The developer who once proposed a mosque and Muslim community center near 9/11's Ground Zero now plans to build a museum devoted to Islam at the same site. The New York Times reports Sharif El-Gamal wants to build a museum dedicated to exploring the faith of Islam and its arts and culture. The building would include a sanctuary for prayer services and community programs. No word yet on how the project would be funded. Well, today is the annual National Day of Prayer, and people are taking part in an estimated 40,000 events around the country, many at both local and national government buildings, including Capitol Hill right here in Washington, D.C. You can find out more about the National Day of Prayer and get the latest from CBN News by going to our website at cbnnews.com. Pat and Terry will be back with more of the 700 Club right after this.
At 69, I'm starting a whole new chapter in my life.
Lifestyle Lift, a life-changing procedure that helps remove wrinkles, frown lines, and sagging skin on your face and neck.
I have a younger look and a new look on life.
Look, almost 200,000 lives changed. Lifestyle Lift is the affordable way to looking years younger.
Nothing's better than a Lifestyle Lift.
Don't miss your chance for your free skin-firming treatment. Call now, because this amazing offer ends soon.
Every time I see somebody, you look so good, you just never aged. I go, oh, thank you for that. You know?
Would you feel good looking younger and more attractive?
I haven't felt this good in years.
My name is Cindy, I'm 56, but nobody needs to know.
Don't miss your chance for your free skin firming treatment. Call now, because this amazing offer ends soon.
Call now, 800-493-3762.
Don't regret looking older than you feel.
Hi, I'm Terry Musin. At CBN, we're here to pray for you all year long. But each spring, the entire staff of CBN sets aside a special week of prayer to intercede for your needs. Spring is the time of new beginnings, so please send us your requests, no matter how big or small, so we can pray for you. Call us now or mail your prayer request today. It's our privilege to pray for you. Throughout this week, our staff has met in the Regent Chapel to pray for you, our CBN partners. You can join us if you'd like by logging on to cbn.com today. That's at noon Eastern time. And if you want us to pray for you, all you have to do is give us a call at 1-800-759-0700. We want to show you now what prayer did for one family in Florida after their daughter was lost and wandered several miles from home. They had no leads until a member of her church heard a voice from above.
On the morning of April 10th, 2010, 11-year-old Nadia Bloom hopped on her bike and sped off toward the wooded area at the end of her subdivision to take some pictures of nature. But she didn't return.
About 20 minutes, 30 minutes, I stepped outside the door waiting for her to circle around and tell her to come in. And when she didn't do that, that's when I got in the car to go look for her.
Tanya was especially concerned because the area around the family's home in Seminole County, Florida, is rife with alligators and other predators.
I knew there would be two places she'd go. There's a little play place and there's a pond. And so I drove toward the pond first and I saw her bike in the cul-de-sac, and her bike was parked neatly right by the pond with her helmet on the handlebars.
Tanya went looking for her daughter in the dense thicket near the pond. When she couldn't find her, she called 911. Within hours, local and state authorities set up a massive search operation.
It's a surreal moment. You're feeling like this isn't happening. I can't believe this is happening. And, you know, where is she?
Soon, night began to fall, and still no sign of Nadia.
Everything that you believe in God is going to be tested. And you have to make a decision. You know, is he who he said he was? And we chose to believe that no matter what.
As word spread throughout the community, the Bloom's pastor gathered people to pray.
It was a very open, honest night of people just calling before God, just saying, God, please intervene. This is beyond our control, and we really need you.
The search continued for several days, and Nadia's story gained national attention.
Investigators worked through the night trying to find 11-year-old Nadia Bloom in the dense woods near her home.
As time went on, the other alternatives to her being found start to become more of a reality, and you start trying to come to terms with those other events happening.
There was times where I would have hope, and there would be times where, like Jeff said, she could have been taken by somebody, and that's a whole nother avenue. If someone took her, what could be happening to her?
All the while, townspeople continued their outpouring of prayers and support.
Her school had sent home some letters from one class, and there was a child that said, you know, hope will bring her home, and I just started weeping. But again, that restored the hope, you know, from this little kid.
One of the prayers that I had when I prayed, and it was almost constant, was that whatever happened, God would be glorified through these events.
4 days passed, and still search and rescue teams came up empty-handed. Then there was a lead, but it didn't come from a search party or helicopter. James King, a member of the Bloom's Church, says God told him where to look for Nadia. He later gave his account to CBN News.
And it was a still small voice, but that was, he led me in different cases, telling me, you know, yes, go this way, don't go that way.
That afternoon, James made a call to 911 with news that the Bloom family and the town of Winter Springs had been waiting 4 days to hear.
911, location emergency.
Hey, I've got her. I got Nadia.
Seminole with the transfer.
Okay, call her. Okay, I'm in the middle of the swamp.
To go from that depth of emotion and go to that exhilaration in the span of a few seconds is unbelievable. I ran into the bedroom and I almost broke down the door to tell Tanya, and the whole house erupted, and it was just awesome.
The people in the Bloom's neighborhood threw Nadia a welcome home party. Jeff Bloom says his prayer that God would be glorified was answered.
There are people around the world that sent us letters and called and emails praying for Nadia. And I had people email me that didn't have faith. And they'd say, I don't believe, but this is as close to a miracle as, you know, I've ever seen.
Some of the details of the ordeal are already starting to fade for Nadia, but she'll never forget that there is a God who still does miracles today.
It was very miraculous. I remember when I was little, I questioned if God was always there for us, but he does that. I mean, really.
No matter how scary it is, you have to keep your trust in him.
He knows your name. He knows the number of hairs on your head. God is very personal with us.
The thing about it is, he knows everything.
It's way beyond, His wisdom is way beyond us. If we would open our minds and our hearts to receive it, but we shut it out, we know so much. Don't tell me about this. It's not scientific. Okay, we're going to pray. And here's somebody who said, I need a financial turnaround for my suffering retail business. A husband needs to find a good job. A son needs to be healed of prostate cancer. And there's an inoperable brain tumor. What do you have?
Well, here's someone saying, I need healing from a stroke and a rare peritoneal cancer. It's an abdominal lining. Someone asking for wisdom, strength, and patience to deal with my husband's dementia. Someone else saying, I need to be healed from AFib and diabetes. Someone else saying, I need a financial blessing. My home is in foreclosure. I'm unable to work due to a workplace injury still unresolved from 3 years ago.
Wow. Look, the silver is His, and the gold is His. The cattle on 1,000 hills are His. The oil under the ground is His. The wealth of nations is His. It's all His. So why wouldn't He give a little piece of it to you if you need it? It's His, and you're His child. Now, we're going to join. We're going to believe God. Father,
thank you, God.
There are people crying out particularly for a financial miracle right now. And Lord, you have the treasury of heaven. You have all the gold and all the silver and all the oil and all the animals and all the plants and all the wealth in the world. It's yours. Now, these people are saying, we are in desperate need. Help us. Lord, first of all, give them wisdom to how to manage their finances, and then give them the blessing they need in the name of Jesus.
Thank you.
And Lord, we pray for others who are hurting and sick. Terry?
There's someone, you have some serious mouth and dental issues, and you've not been able to have the work done because of finances. God's going to provide that for you, and your mouth is going to be totally put back together.
Somebody, your name is Marcia, and you have lupus, and you're praying with me right now, and God has just reached out to your home, and that lupus is going away. You're going to be completely clean. Any lesions in your face are gone. You're going to be completely whole, and you're going to praise God. Raise your hands and say, thank you, Jesus. It's yours. Mm-hmm. Terry, you have anything else?
Someone else, you have when I say mental confusion, it's more than just being forgetful. You have serious mental confusion. It's so frustrating and upsetting to you. God is going to provide exactly what's needed to clear your mind right now. It's there's a chemical imbalance. You're not even aware of what it is. In Jesus' name, you're healed.
We have before us 1,000 or so prayer requests. We've gotten almost 100,000 prayer requests. We're going to symbolically lay hands on them and believe for you. Father, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, listen to the prayer of your people and hear and do and show yourself strong.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Terry.
Up next, the man called the pastor's pastor and the Pentecostal gold standard. We're going to sit down with Jack Hayford after this.
What can that be?
52-year-old male complaining of chest pains.
Clear! Heart attacks can happen at any time. My name is Dr. Crandall, and as a cardiologist, I tell my patients that they need to be aware of the hidden symptoms of a heart attack. Here's the truth. If you suffer cardiac arrest outside of a hospital, you have just a 7% chance of surviving. That is why I've created the Simple Heart Test, to help you determine your own risk of heart disease. Go online today, and in just 2 minutes, you'll discover your risk of suffering a heart attack, how you score on my heart disease risk factor scale, plus the key warning signs your heart is in trouble. Over 2 million Americans have already taken my Simple Heart Test, and I urge you to do so now, before it's too late.
Take your free online heart test today and discover how to get Dr. Crandall's bestseller, The Simple Heart Cure. Go to simpleharttest.com today.
Visit Vonage.com for home phone service, and you could save 39% versus a traditional home phone plan. With Vonage, you'll get over 25 great features, plus award-winning customer service. Get Vonage today and save with our special intro price.
Friday.
Big Brother is going to school and watching what your children type.
They can track our children all the way down to the keystroke level.
Hear how privacy experts are fighting back. And then, lost in the canyons.
We could not find the road.
With no water or cell phone signal, our week of prayer continues.
It's going to be okay. Grab here, grab there.
Friday on the 700 Club.
Well, many years ago, a young baby was stricken with a life-threatening illness. Friends and family prayed for him, and he was healed. Even doctors said there was no explanation except the grace of God snatched him back from the brink of death. That child's name was Jack Hayford, and it wasn't the last time he saw firsthand the miracle-working power of God.
Jack Hayford has been in ministry for more than 50 years. He's best known for founding the Church on the Way in Van Nuys, California, where he served as senior pastor for more than three decades. In 1997, Jack founded the King's University, formerly the King's College and Seminary, in Los Angeles, where he still serves as chancellor. As an author, Jack has written over 40 books. Penetrating the Darkness is his first book on spiritual warfare.
Jack Hayford is here with us now, and it is always a pleasure to have you visit with us.
Always a pleasure to be here, Terry.
You've written, along with your daughter, Rebecca, who's also a prolific writer, in your family, Penetrating the Darkness, a book about really spiritual warfare. At this point in time in history, Jack, why is this so important?
Well, I think the nature of the whole atmosphere of our society is not just affected by human failure, but the place that is given through human blindness and the sheer and raw cruelty and brutality of the adversary, knowing that he's coming down to, you know, the showdown finally is coming, and I think the adversary is not at all ignorant of this, and the concentration of increase of battle. If you consider that the Apostle Paul said that that in first century says we're wrestling with principalities and powers, that wrestling match only increases in intensity. And I think this is a great deal, Terry, that people fail to discern. It's not a matter of superstitiously saying everything that happens is the devil. Mm-hmm. But there's a good deal more than often people identify that is that. And in fact, even things sometimes God gets blamed for.
Yes, exactly. Mm-hmm. Well, you say the adversary is very aware of it, but we often are not. You say that Christians sometimes pray in the same way we would rub a rabbit's foot for good luck. What do you mean by that?
Well, I just mean that there's a good deal of prayer that is superstition. But I don't think it's very often Christians. I think there are many people who do know the Lord and are very immature in their prayer life for want of teaching and want of churches where there's a vibrant prayer ministry. Mm-hmm. And so there's some of that. But I think sloganeering God, he has a great heart, and he knows when our hearts really, truly do have need. Yeah. But when we bandy around words that we suppose that this will cure a problem by knowing, for example, as deeply as I believe in the importance of making a confession of faith in the Word of God when you receive a promise, I think sometimes people even treat the concept of faith, well, I've said the magical verses that go with this problem.
Surely God will
and,
jump to
yes, and, and those things I would parallel to rabbit's foot rubbing, although quoting a scripture may be a rung up on rabbit's feet.
God did speak to your heart about daily devotional prayer in your life, the discipline of that. Mm-hmm. What did you feel the Lord was saying to you?
Well, what happened, I had, over the early years at the Church on the Way, as the Lord was really, there was a breakthrough in understanding and vitality of the spirit of worship in the church, and continues to this day for that matter, which is gratifying to observe in that Ann and I are attenders now at the church. When we're home, I'm out speaking quite a bit, but it's a delight to see the health of the church on the way today. Worship life and the intercessory ministry of the church was very strong. And in that time, these two things had begun to worship and intercession And the Lord just said, your personal devotional habit, you've forgotten that discipline.
Yeah.
And it wasn't as though I didn't pray daily. It's that there were patterns of prayer that I was attentive, for example, to pray. I didn't stop praying for our children every day, but there are things that I felt I need to give attention to these daily, not as a superstitious mandate of God, but to keep my heart tuned before God about that part of our life. I think oftentimes prayer, presenting ourselves to the Lord on issues that we list, prayer lists, is not just a recitation as though we were making a required speech, but something that keeps our hearts truly tuned to fresh movement of the Holy Spirit in your life when you pray for that. I think the language of the Spirit is a tremendous gift that the Holy Spirit gives to assist our prayer lives, to, as the Bible says in Romans 8, that we don't always know how precisely we may need to pray, and that He'll help us hit the target. And that's important, of invoking the presence and power of God, not that He couldn't do it anyway, but the Lord wants our partnership.
Yeah.
And what He's doing in
us.
This world.
Yeah.
Yeah, He really does. He can get along without us, but he likes us and wants to grow us up. God is somehow fixated with this idea that He wants His kids to grow up.
Yes.
You know, so, and our prayer life is a great part of that. Yeah. And the discipline of daily devotional habit is incorporated in this book, Penetrating the Darkness, as a foundational basic to our life. I mainly in that book, however, wanted to address the nature of the spiritual warfare and then not to be intimidated by it, and to recognize that the conquest that overcomes already has been established through the cross, but it is to be applied the same way that you apply the provision of the cross for your salvation when you receive Christ. Appropriating what is provided is an action, and in prayer, we apply the triumph of Calvary to circumstances where there are, in fact, ferocious works of darkness, especially.
Yeah. And understanding the ground that we stand on because of what Christ did. We can't hardly understand the battle or how to function in it if we don't know that. These are basics.
They really are. And when you say to understand the place that we have, it's so important to taking a stance where you have peace and confidence that the power of prayer is generated by the Spirit and established through the cross and the promise of God.
Yeah.
And I think understanding that moves it from feeling that there's some mystery of something we do. Our role is to pray. Mm-hmm. You have not because you ask not.
Yeah.
But when you ask because of Calvary and the promises of the Word, then you've got grounds to stand on.
Position.
But the cross is pivotal in the spiritual warfare.
Penetrating the Darkness is the name of the book. If you want to know how to wage spiritual warfare, get Jack's book. It'll also change your prayer life. It's available nationwide where books are sold. Thank you for being here.
Always
great to have you.
Delight.
Pat?
Jack Hayford's a dear friend. It's so nice to see him again. Well, thank you for watching this edition of the 700 Club. We leave you with today's Power Minute from Psalm 34. The angel of the Lord encamps all around those who fear Him and delivers them. For Terry and all of us, this is Pat Robertson, and we'll see you tomorrow. Bye-bye.
Friday, Big Brother is going to school and watching what your children type.
They can track our children all the way down to the keystroke level.
Hear how privacy experts are fighting back. And then, lost in the canyons.
We could not find the road.
With no water or cell phone signal. Our week of prayer continues.
It's going to be okay. Grab here, grab there.
Friday on the 700 Club.
Hello, I'm Terry Newsom. Did you know there are more than 148 million orphans in the world today? 148 million. But it was three little girls that taught me about the plight of orphans. 8 years ago, my husband and I spent nearly a month immersed in the daily activities of a Ukrainian orphanage as we waited to adopt three sisters. I saw firsthand the utter loneliness, the pain of rejection, and the overwhelming desire to be loved. That experience changed me forever. And out of it grew a ministry from my heart called Orphans Promise, Today, we're helping orphans and vulnerable children in more than 50 countries worldwide. Thousands of children are now in safe homes. They're being educated, and they're learning life skills. I'm asking you to join with me and become family to these children. Will you call the number on your screen right now? Because every child deserves a chance to be happy.